Hey everybody, welcome in. Welcome to the show. Thank you for coming. And yes, we are still a little bit weak out there, but things look like they've stabilized just a touch. But I'm going to talk about what the rest of the world is doing. I know you're worried about your own kind of portfolios and everything else, but it's important to see what the really smart money is actually doing and how they're tackling it. So this is going to be in a video dedicated entirely to just Bitcoin, because it is clearly leading the market. Whatever Bitcoin does, the rest of the market does, to a large extent. We're also going to talk about correlations to equities, risk on, risk off, leverage ratios, and a whole bunch more. So let's jump in. Math, money, and freedom. And of course, this is edutainment. So the whales are stacking like mad. No doubt about that. But who and why? Let me just give you a couple of examples. First of all, Binance just bought 43,000 Bitcoin at $46,553. That is a big chunk of Bitcoin to buy. And they're adding it to their wallet that has over $5.5 billion worth. Now, I did talk a week or so ago about the fact that 100,000 Bitcoin are being drained from exchange every month. This one transaction makes up half of that amount, which is very, very substantial. So again, Binance is buying. They're going to use this to peg it to a new product that they're doing as well. That'll be Bitcoin-based. So watch those guys. In addition, the third largest Bitcoin whale just bought another bunch, and they've been layering in all the way down from 50,000. And right now, they have a wallet with about 121,000 Bitcoin. Let me pop this up. And this actually, coincidentally, is larger than, or it's actually a little bit smaller than, I think, Michael Saylor's wallet, which has about 124,391 Bitcoins. So interesting to see that, again, third largest Bitcoin whale is also buying. So again, these guys are stacking. But why? What do they see that we don't? So this is probably the most important chart of this particular video. And excuse my red squiggle, but it's kind of to highlight price action over the last year or so. Now, what I'm trying to prove here is the typical movements are disjointed. So excuse the squiggle, but either the laws of economics, i.e. supply and demand, are dead, or something is very strange here. So I believe typically, as supply is drained off exchanges, you can see this chart indicates illiquid supply. This is stuff that comes off the exchanges and goes into cold storage. It's going up. And when that happens, price normally goes up. So you can see the way the red squiggle typically follows the yellow mountain, let's call it. But it broke down over the last month and a half. And the question is, why? Why? Bitcoin has been drained off the exchanges and price is going down. That will break. So that gives me a lot of bullish sentiment, because that is typically not normal. Now let's talk about what we're hearing on the social channels. This is from Sentiment. All of the keywords on all the crypto social channels, the top 10 words are dip, nice, buy, fed, market, dips, buying, Bitcoin, bear, and sell. So you can see, and these are stat ranked. So the number one word is dip. Number four word is fed, obviously impacting the market. But everybody's talking about dips twice, buying twice. So that is, for me, extremely bullish. So the retail investors on social channels are looking to buy and buy the dip too, like the whales. So that's important to look at. Now let's talk about the extreme fear level we are at now. Per this article here, the market wrap, Bitcoin sentiment turns extremely bearish. Now, we did have a sell-off that resulted in about $800 million in liquidations. I'll talk more about them in a minute. But it didn't, while we had an accelerated price move down, it didn't really change much of the sentiment. So either there's a couple of issues going on here. Either the wick down wasn't large enough to take all the levered traders out, or something else is going on. So let's dig into that a little bit more. But typically, it's unusual. Now, when we look at extreme fear, when it is really high at this level, it hit 15 today, this is typically a good time to buy. But remember in the summer, that should be 2021, but May, June, July, we had extreme fear down around 15, 10 to 15 for 3 months almost. And we just hit it today. And that typically means, you know, I don't know how long we could stay down here, but be prepared. But the point is, the whales are buying and the supply has been drained from exchanges. But there's lots more other good news too. So this one is a theory that I have had for a while. And the question is, Bitcoin may gain an upper hand against stocks in 2022. So basically, stocks are at all-time highs in terms of valuations. Everybody's expecting some type of correction in the stock market. We don't know if that's going to happen. If the money printing continues, yes. But if they stop money printing and they jack rates, that could bring valuations down for the stock market, causing the stock market to come down. Now, there is a theory that Bitcoin may gain the upper hand against stocks because of their valuations and being at an all-time high and because of these rate hikes. So we'll see what happens. But a reason to take a look at this is the fact that also the S&P 500 is the most extended above its 60-month moving average in over 20 years. So if you've been looking at the S&P 500 for 30 years, you'll see it is very, very stretched. And stretch markets have become common, but commodities and Bitcoin appear to be early reversion leaders. People will use that as a safe haven asset. So we'll see. I do believe one day this will be the safe haven asset, but right now, you can see per this, it's somehow correlated to some extent. But before we jump in there, there was a guy from Coin Bureau who was chatting on Twitter today about the decoupling from equities. And I decided to drop a comment below his tweet as well. So I said, guy, it's only a matter of time until Bitcoin becomes a safe haven asset or a risk-off asset instead of risk-on asset. It's mathematically programmed. Oh, and it's already less volatile than many equities out there in the S&P 500. So speaking about volatility for a second here, you can see the Bitcoin's volatility was 12x the NASDAQ stock market in 2013, 8x in 2017, and only 4x in 2022. But remember, over a third of S&P equities are actually more volatile than Bitcoin. So that's interesting to look at. Now let's look at correlation as well between equities and Bitcoin. Here, Bitcoin as of late has been kind of highly correlated in 2020 and 2021. And you can see here the green coefficient of when they move in unison. Now, this is the 100-day correlation coefficient, and the coin, Bitcoin and the S&P 500 is now standing at about 0.44, and that's the highest such reading since the fourth quarter of 2020. Now, a coefficient of 1 means the assets are moving in lockstep, while -1 would show they move in the opposite direction. Now, I believe this correlation could change over the next year or so. We could go red. We could go red sooner than later, perhaps, which would mean that if people are moving out of equities and it goes red, they're moving into something like Bitcoin. That's what kind of we're looking for. We may get, we'll see. Might be too early, but eventually it'll come. And let's talk about Bitcoin cycles and volatility comparisons. So this is from the RationalRoot, supported by Bitcoin Magazine. You can see in 2011, huge volatility, huge vertical spike. 2013, less, about half of the volatility and spike. 2017, less again. And 2021, ooh, kind of like almost flatlining to some extent. Still, there's an upward slope. But the question is, what will the drawdown equal to previous cycles? And will we bounce off that trend line? We see that we are right on it right now. So the overall trend should be up, but it comes down, it corrects, and we just have to see where it goes. Now, the real fact of the matter is the fact that Bitcoin has become such a big asset. Of course, it's not going to go from 1 trillion to 2 trillion in a matter of days or weeks, as was the market cap in the past. And incremental investments don't move the needle as much. So that's kind of where we are. But I thought that was interesting to see that the volatility of the asset class is coming down, which is a good thing for institutional investors too. Now let's look at TechDev. He views the world in kind of ranges in his latest tweet today. 2021, he describes as a consolidation period. And we can see that clearly from some of the accumulation. And it all hovered around that 40K level. Yes, we fell to 29K in the summer, bounced up to 67K a couple of times. And that 40K level is at the Fib 2.272 level. Now, just as in 2019, 2020, the consolidation period is around 9K at the 0.382 level. So this is not unlike my three-step diagram, although we've deviated a little bit from my third step and come down to between the second and third step, but we'll see. It's just a weak time right now. Now let's look at where the big money is coming in. Mike Novogratz, he did speak about a 42K floor. I didn't even realize till I read this article, but it seems like many of us are coalescing around that 42K level. Bitcoin is just north of 43K right now. Let me check. And 42,968. So we're just $18 away. We're 20, 30, 40 bucks away from that level of 43K. Now, he did walk back his 42K floor. He said a couple of things that was kind of interesting. One, first of all, the big news is he believes we could maybe go as low as 38K. And he believes the U.S. Federal Reserve has knocked it down a bit because of their tapering and, of course, maybe hiking interest rates. And this is a factor he believes contributing to Bitcoin's dip or crash, according to Mike Novogratz. Now, we lost, according to him as well, the 46K support level. And it's critical to hold the 41K level. And if we don't, I call it the 42K level. And if we don't, he believes we could fall to 38. But that is his new max floor. So we'll see. I think many would welcome a dip of 38, but I'm also seeing a lot of extreme pessimism from some people hoping for 20K. And you've got the crazies like Harry Dent saying, oh, Bitcoin's going to 7,000 and all that silly stuff. So just be careful what you listen to. And I will share some more of that type of sentiment as well in a minute. But the point here, though, the other interesting thing he did say is a tremendous amount of institutional demand is on the sidelines, ready to buy. So if there is a dip from here, it'll be bought up very quickly. And in fact, we're already seeing it being bought up right now by some of the smartest whales out there. Number three, Bitcoin whale, and Binance buying a lot. So let's talk about this one. This is from Mike McGlone, Bloomberg. He spoke about the Bitcoin hash rate and price and what he calls the 10x multiple. So this is one where he, you know, I always say that Bitcoin price follows the hash rate, and he kind of weaved that in as well. So he believes the 2021 hash rate crash solidified Bitcoin's price foundation. You know, the China ban, etc., the mining shifting to North American public companies and Kazakhstan, who we'll talk about too as well, and many of which are more inclined to hold coins now. The miners aren't selling coins, so those coins aren't hitting the market. And investments in miners is increasing because it gives indirect exposure to crypto, and that's very popular with companies like BlackRock, who are very shrewd investors and have big positions in companies like CleanSpark. But Bitcoin, following that 10x price appreciation increment, is what they are honing in on here. So if you look at the graphic, it depicts the last time the network computing power measure from Coinmetrics had a similar decline of about 50% as last year. The hash rate, 10-day average, dropped about 30% in 2018, and Bitcoin bottomed at 3,000 in 2021. And in 2021, the drawdown to about 30,000 from 60,000 supports our view that crypto continues to appreciate in 10x increments. That's kind of the idea behind that, is basically the ultimate floor. Like, of course, we're never going to see $3,000 again. But the ultimate floor, as far as they're concerned, based on the hash rate, would be 30,000 right now. Let's talk about Bitcoin dominance. That also took a bit of a hit. The net dollar inflows needed to sustain Bitcoin at 40% market dominance are significantly lower than the dollar inflows need to sustain the rest of the crypto market cap. This is from Ryan Selkis. And I agree with this heavily. Now, let's look at the Bitcoin dominance first. You can see we're back at the January 2018 levels, which is not that good. And it's January 2022. There's a couple of patterns there. One is it's 4 years later and we're at the same level. But the market is extremely different right now than it was in the past. Obviously, there are other cryptos that are a lot larger and bigger. Think Ethereum, think other L1s. But it is uncanny to see where we are. Now, the sluggish start to 2022 in terms of returns. I think Bitcoin's down about 33% and Ethereum's down about 22% from their all-time highs, which really takes us down to this level. But other names are bigger. Now, the question is, what happens as we go forward? So if you look at all the other crypto stuff out there, I would say 95% of it will go to zero. But look at the growth and number of names. January 2021, 8,000 cryptos. Today, there's 16,000 cryptos. It doesn't take a lot to set up a new crypto asset or do a fork in an existing asset. Not a lot at all. Hence the doubling of cryptos. And again, maybe it's more like 99% that will go to zero. But the point of Ryan's comment is it doesn't take a lot to sustain the price of Bitcoin because there's so little supply. But when you have very inflationary tokens and money grabs and scams out there, they're a lot more, they take a lot more cash to keep inflated because of inflation. So I agree with that. And there's a couple of examples there, which I won't bring up, but some of them have crazy inflation numbers. Check out Alluvium. One of the reasons I don't buy these games, I think the Alluvium number, I can't remember what it is, it's like 400% inflation a year. Go figure. Anyway, let's talk about Bitcoin leverage ratio. This is another key aspect as well. It's a bit of an eye chart, but as you can see in this graph, the Bitcoin leverage ratio seems to have not changed much, even after the big dip we've just had. And this can mean two things. And that's the kind of like the gray arrow under the blue line. Considering the price has fallen so much, the blue line, the leverage ratio is still going up. So either means two things. Either the positions currently open on exchanges are mostly short positions, or the price drop wasn't sharp enough to kill the long positions, the margin long positions. So we'll see how this plays out over the next couple of days. Now, speaking of derivatives in the market, this was an interesting graph as well. Big thank you to Sanjay for sending it to me. This talks about the share, the market share. So if you look at this wheel here, 70% now is made up of Binance and FTX. FTX is growing very rapidly in the derivatives market. And we're seeing a big bifurcation of activity on those exchanges too. US volume in crypto derivatives is a single digit percentage of the 3 trillion of the global derivative market. But yesterday it was 2%. Now, a robust U.S. derivatives market for crypto would satisfy the abundant demand and bring more stability to the U.S. spot markets for crypto as well. This is promising signs that we're heading in this direction in 2022. Again, everything is stabilizing. Everything is becoming less volatile. And hence, we see the lower lines, which is a good thing for the asset class. It won't be as exciting. It won't be, oh, Bitcoin's going to go from 30,000 to 300,000 in a couple of weeks. But it's stabilizing as an asset as we go forward. Let's talk about some of the math behind Banco Generali. A couple of people asked me, well, what does it mean for Bitcoin price? So I'm going to go through my model again, which I've done a few times before. But basically, if you look at all these banks that are kind of onboarding retail investors, what does it mean for Bitcoin price? So if you imagine Banco Generali, they have 300,000 customers. Assets are $87 billion. The assets per customer are about $290,000. Now, if you assume 10% of those customers elect to invest in Bitcoin, that would mean 30,000 customers. And if they put in 5% of their assets, a typical allocation that many people recommend, that would mean about $435 million. You multiply that by our Bitcoin multiplier, 25, you divide it by the number of Bitcoin, you get an impact of price of about $776. Now, that is not very exciting to many, but the point is it's one bank. Imagine Sparkasse coming on board as well. That'll be a lot bigger than this bank and many others. So you got Italy, Germany, and many other countries coming on board real fast. And on top of that, you got the big institution money coming in Q1, the money that people like Mike Novogratz and Raoul Paul speak to. Again, it's only a matter of time, everybody. The supply is becoming scarce. So I know it's a dark day, but hang tough. But then we have got people like Gareth Soloway. Obviously, this guy comes out on Yahoo Finance and he says, gold will outperform everything. Everything. It'll be the best performing asset of 2022. So no video would be complete without some information from the other side. So this guy only does TA. You cannot tell where a market's going by just looking at TA alone. And that's why we have Taco Tuesdays. So we look at on-chain too. It's a new word we're working on. So, but this guy last week said he went long, I think around 52K. And now he says gold will be, he went long into Bitcoin with some options or Bitcoin itself. I'm not sure exactly what he did. But now he says gold will beat the stock market and Bitcoin and everything else after 11-year slump. And if you take into account loss of purchasing power, my calculations, gold lost more than 44%. So he must be a major gold bug. But don't believe this. Okay, Mike McGlone from Bloomberg says that Bitcoin continues to eat at gold's market share, and that's very apparent from the ETF records and transactions over the last year, and it's only accelerating. So more money is going into Bitcoin and money is not going into gold. That'll only suppress the price for gold. Yeah, it could hit 2000, but you know, other assets are going to go up more. Let's talk a little bit about some geopolitical news. Russia, as you know, in my 2022 projections, I was very worried about Russia invading the Ukraine or China invading Taiwan. Apparently, I have to change my calculus a little bit. So Russia airdropped some paratroopers into Kazakhstan because of some, obviously, domestic uncertainty. But I don't know exactly what Putin's plan is with these peacekeeping forces and putting them in there. But one thing to note about Kazakhstan is they have 13% approximately of the global Bitcoin hash rate. All the Chinese miners moved to Kazakhstan. They are the number one producer of uranium, and clean energy is going to be very important for the future. So it's important to get a handle on that uranium. And they produce 1.6 billion barrels of oil a day. Again, this is a fancy bounty. So we'll see. I don't know what Putin will do, if he's going to pull troops from the Ukraine's border, stick them in Kazakhstan, or just stand down and he's just there as a good neighbor. I don't know. But either way, this type of position would enhance Russia's natural resources and standing in Central Asia, perhaps. But we'll watch this carefully. Very interesting development. Now, speaking of miners and mining, the miners are still profitable, despite the fact that the whole sector has been beaten to death recently. But the margins, they still should be profitable as long as the Bitcoin price stays above 20K. I haven't done the recent calculations about how much hash rate, but I will be doing that very shortly. Now, one guy in analysis called Christopher Brendler said he believes that the stocks at these prices offer superior risk reward to buying Bitcoin spot himself. I always say buy the pure form, but this guy apparently thinks different. And he sees limited downside from here, and he likes marathon mining the best. So I completely disagree with this guy about his choices and everything else, but we'll see. He said as well, I think, barring a complete destruction of price of Bitcoin falling below 10K, he believes it's still a safe investment. I definitely don't see that happening. Anyway, the point is, he believes miners are good again, and they are definitely on sale. Now, in a little bit of sad news, the Pampit twins, they sadly both passed. Igor Bogdanov just died of C19, 6 days after his twin brother Grichka died of the same illness. I think they were both about 72 or 74 years of age. And they were famously tied and associated with Bitcoin. So may they both rest in peace. And they are famous French actors, film actors. So sad to see them gone, but I think they'll live with us forever in infamy in the crypto world and Bitcoin world. So with that, I'm going to open up to a couple of questions, drink some water, and hope everybody is still there and doing fine. So there he is. We got some of the usual suspects back in town. Got Luke Broyles. What are the best hedges against war black swan event? Real estate, USD, energy stocks, being heavy in crypto tech. Risky, but heavy in USD seems too risky too. So it's a tricky one, Luke. The best thing really to have on hand, because if there is a big black swan event, things will fall real fast. And the way markets work nowadays is they fall much more rapidly than in the past. In the past, it would take 2 weeks for things to flesh out through the markets. Nowadays, it's an instant cascade because there's so much leverage in the markets. So we see that as well with crypto. It's like Crispo. That's weird. So some type of very stable stablecoin or fiat cash is the best thing. Now, real estate, if you have your home, you have your castle, real estate typically doesn't fall that much during a crash and rebounds very quick, especially if it's in an area with very, very fixed supply. Energy stocks, I wouldn't touch. They would get hit all across the board. But I think the best thing to have is definitely have some cash on hand, at least that 20% cash pile, if you do believe things could go sideways in the future, or have a very safe stablecoin that you could move into. But even some stablecoins could have their risk too, like Tether. And if there was a big cascading market loss, the Tether itself or other stablecoins could lose their peg, and that's another risk too. So at the end of the day, it's okay to hold fiat for a short window of time, but not too long. If you hold it for 1, 2, 3, 4 months, it's fine. But you don't want to be planning to hold cash for a long time, because Ray Dalio will tell you cash is trash. So X-ray vision, do you think the whales are walking fine lines trying to manipulate Bitcoin down for accumulation, that they turn off retail institutional investors for good? I think there's a little bit of a risk of that, but you know, it doesn't take a lot of smart retail investors to understand that these are transformational times. Everybody knows Bitcoin is super scarce. It's programmed to go up. If as many retail investors, one of the reasons I do this is to, the reason this happened is because I did a video to try to convince retail investors to get some when it was about $9,000. But the key is, they are definitely turning some people off. There's also a lot of crazy sentiment out there in the marketplace. You have people who are investing for the first time ever. They got into the market because of crypto over the last 2 years, and they have completely unreasonable expectations. You know, people expect 10Xs, 100Xs, 1000Xs. It's all about get rich quick. And that is not a good frame of mind to have in this market. Again, 95% of crypto is going to zero. Stock market returns will not be as high as last year. And if you look at all the stock market returns anyway from last year, it was all sucked up by the big black holes, you know, the Googles, the Teslas, etc. It wasn't the typical small companies. So we'll see what happens. But I just hope people can keep the faith. I think everybody needs an allocation of Bitcoin because it's so scarce and we're so early. That's the big beauty of it. Cryptolicious, do we still like Polygon? Yes. Did you check my should I sell video for Polygon? Everything's laid out there. I know they had a little bit of an outage because you know, chains that are growing so fast and getting so busy that have very cheap transaction fees are victims of their own success. Solana, Polygon, the fact that Ethereum is congested is because it's so busy. You know, they're just processing so many transactions. So Polygon had some problems yesterday or today with Sunflowers, I think. A new play, a new game just took it down. So it can happen. Again, it's early. Everything is early. Everything is new. Everything is untested at scale. But yeah, still like Polygon, but I am exiting out. I sold a fifth of my bag at about 275 or 280, I can't remember, and it's dipped down. If it goes below 2, I'll buy more, and then I'll sell it again. So that's my plan. So IROC 007, can you recommend a 1/3 to replace real estate with? I don't want to deal with tenants. my other 1/3 are crypto and stocks. Also, Gala compendium score. Gala compendium score is horrific. It's really bad. So I can tell you, I can get that one out of the way. I know it's a game and it's huge growth and everything else, but it does not score well in the compendium. In fact, none of the kind of metaverse gaming plays do. Illuvium, 400-500% inflation. And I just don't like inflation. It's against my religion. So just want to share that. Now, in terms of other thirds, what you could do, what people typically would invest is just think of really, really safe, gentle number go up stocks. You could even think about ones that pay a little dividend like Apple. Apple could be good. Amazon is very good. I think Amazon is very undervalued. It's not going to go below 3,000. It might in a black swan event for a little while, but we'll be right back up. But if you rip out AWS from Amazon, that's worth, you know, $1 trillion by itself. So that's a good asset. And of course, the usual suspects, your Googles, your Teslas. I mean, if you have enough diversification, like 4 or 5 of these great names, then you can take up 2/3 of your portfolio with that level of safety. So if one does blow up, you're still going to be fine because the other ones will completely outperform the market. Nothing but the growth ahead of them. Next question is, we are all Satoshi. Are you keeping your limit order for Phantom at 221? Yes, I have a couple of limit orders out. I think Phantom missed. Let me pull that up. Yes, I do. Yeah, because I have enough Phantom and I'm just holding on to what I have. I'm not buying it unless it's $2 or less, or 221, very low 200s. But I'd rather layer into other things. I did buy a little more Solana yesterday, 147. And Luna didn't hit either. Bitcoin didn't hit. But we'll see. So I'm hanging tight. And I also, I'm not that flush with cash right now. I'm in a cash position for two reasons. Safety, and of course, to convert some leaps that are converting from names like Shopify and Google, etc. And some more Tesla leaps too. We are all Satoshi. Yes, thank you for that question. And a big thank you for your donation as well. German Girl in Virginia, just for Luke Broyles, always in the trigger. Yeah, he's quick. He's quick on the draw. And thank you, James Sanad. So I see you twice today. Latrol2, MT Ozma, playing with pastels, a bottle of red. Caligula, Paul Demond, Mark Greenwood, Global Party People. Haven't seen you in a while, Global Party People. Thank you so much. Hope the music business is going well. Mikko Man, Quacken357, St. Jude needs us, as always. Jeeves, hope you and the new house are doing well and the family. GT350, Luke Funo, Breakbeat Stu, Abdul Muhammad, and Bad Pangolin. All the usual suspects. Love you all. Thanks for everything. That's a wrap for now, and I'll see you tomorrow. And again, hang tough with Bitcoin. You know, even if it's down now, stack what you can. I wish I could buy more myself. 42,800. One of the few videos where Bitcoin fell $100. The juju may not be there today. But again, watch what the big guys are doing. Watch the on-chain data. It's super scarce. Thanks all.